Worship set this morning, and the theme was the battle, and it really tied in with my week. It also ties in with kind of what we've been talking about as we look towards the getting ready for. We talked last week about the rapture, and this morning we'll be talking a little bit about the second coming. And truly, the battle is the Lord's. The ultimate victory belongs to our God, amen? And this is something that's going to be really good for us to keep in mind, even when we have hardships and struggles. How many of you know Christians aren't exempt from hardships and struggles? We don't get a pass, folks. But the ultimate victory is ours through Jesus. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we're thankful for that. So I talked to you last week about the rapture of the church. The Greek word there is harpazo, the great gathering up or the great catching away. And scripture tells us that Jesus is going to appear in the clouds, and he is going to take the church, his bride, to go and be with him. Shared with you last week that it's the most preposterous teaching in all of Christianity. The only thing it has going for it is it's 100% biblical. It's completely true. It's completely accurate. And we await that day. And every saint of God from the first century till today has awaited that day when Jesus would appear in the clouds and take his bride to be home with him. We look forward to his return. We talked about that last week, and we focused on the bride, how we're called the bride of Christ, and how we're living as the bride, and are we living that way, and are we prepared as the bride? We looked at Matthew 25. If you missed the sermon, go ahead on YouTube, and you can catch that from last week. Today, we want to talk about the second coming. The second coming is different from the rapture. Some people don't believe that. They've tried to merge the two together. But regardless of the fact, every believer believes in the second coming. Every believer, no matter your theological background, they all believe that eventually Jesus is going to return to earth. This is a pretty universal belief in all of Christianity, the second coming of Christ. Big differences between the rapture and the second coming. This is why we don't merge them together. I shared some of those with you last week. The biggest one being there's absolutely nothing that needs to take place for the rapture to happen. There's no prophecy that needs to be fulfilled. There's no hoops that need to be jumped through in the spiritual. Everything that is required for the rapture to take place has been in place for a long time since Jesus ascended. He told them to watch. Now, for the second coming to occur, a lot needs to happen. There's a lot of things that need to take place, and we read about this in the book of Revelation and really throughout Scripture. We read about the rise of the Antichrist. We read about the mark of the beast. We read about different things happening on the world stage. There's a lot of things that need to happen before the second coming, but nothing needs to happen before the rapture. It's important to keep those two separate for us. If the main point of the rapture was getting ready and being prepared, main point of the second coming is get ready to win. Get ready for victory. In this world, you will have tribulation, but be of good courage. Be of good cheer, for Jesus has overcome the world. The message of the second coming is a glorious message. We win. Thank you, Jesus. We win. So let's talk about the second coming real quick, give you a little overview. Not going to go super deep into it. We'll do that on Wednesday nights. We're going through our Revelation Bible study, so I encourage you to come out for that or tune into that online. The second coming, on our little rapture, second coming, end times timeline, we're told of a seven-year period of tribulation. And it's really the second 3.5 years of those 7 years where I don't think it's exaggeration to say it's hell on earth. There's some terrible stuff going on. So the timeline looks like this. There's the rapture of the church. Then there's this seven-year period. The last 3.5 are crazy. And then Jesus returns, the second coming. Now, this 7 years, we read about the wrath of God being poured out. Revelation tells us about seven seals, tells us about seven trumpets, seven bowls, each one of them representing a different judgment of God. We're told that during this last 3.5 years that there's the rise of the Antichrist and his government, the mark of the beast. All of these things have to come to pass before the second coming. I have theories on all of this. But it's Wednesday night, so you got to come out Wednesday night. I'm not gonna dive into it on Sunday morning. Part of the reason that all of these terrible judgments come on the earth is because the church, the bride of Christ, has already been removed. God does not punish the righteous with the unrighteous. He doesn't just, everybody's guilty, I'll lose it. No, the pattern through all of Scripture and God's character is the righteous were delivered and the unrighteous were the victims of wrath. Well, as God has taken the church out in the rapture, we have a planet practically devoid of believers. A planet with little to no Christian influence whatsoever. Can you even begin to fathom the depths of sin that this planet will plunge into when the church of Jesus is removed and wickedness is free to do as it will? This is the picture that gets painted for us in this tribulation period. And then the wrath of God is poured out. At the end of this 7-year period, it wraps up with what Revelation calls the Battle of Armageddon. We've heard Armageddon before. That's a cool movie, but it was an asteroid coming to the earth. It had nothing to do with the Bible. The Valley of Megiddo is where this battle takes place. Jesus told his disciples that all the armies of the earth will be gathered around Jerusalem, and then Jesus will come and appear, and he will come down and they will fight this battle. The Battle of Armageddon is the beginning of the second coming where Jesus is going to come. And I want to talk about this second coming this morning, and I'm going to share with you some scripture. At this second coming, when Jesus is coming down for battle, he's not coming down to play games. He's not coming as a baby this time, folks. Jesus comes down, the undefeated king of heaven, to do battle with the armies of the earth. That always blows my mind. I'm blown away by that because we always think, spiritual terms. There's a spiritual thing, and then the physical's over here, and the spiritual's kind of separate. At the Battle of Armageddon, the physical and the spiritual meet. In a very powerful way, as the physical armies of man gather to do battle, Jesus, who we always think is spiritual, physically comes down and fights against them. This is how the second coming is introduced. And Jesus doesn't return alone. Revelation 17:14 says this: they, plural, they will wage war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will triumph over them because he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And with him will be his called, chosen, and faithful followers. The rapture of the church has taken us up. We get to come back. We get to come back with him for his ultimate victory. If you have your Bible, look at Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. This is one of my favorite passages of Scripture, so powerful. Because all throughout Christianity, we've got this humble baby Jesus. And I'm a big fan of humble baby Jesus. And then we have his life, and he's meek. And then we have the cross, and he submits to the will of the Father. In Revelation 19, it's a whole new picture. And this is a picture, I can get down with this. Listen to this, Revelation chapter 19, starting in verse 11, John is speaking. He says, "Now I saw heaven open, and behold," oh, I get goosebumps, "behold a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Give him glory. Give him glory. He's coming back. And when he comes back, people got to answer. When he comes back, he's coming in power with the hosts of heaven, with the saints of God, to do battle against his enemies. I love that picture of Jesus. I love that picture of Jesus. You know who had a glimpse of that picture? Elijah did. Just a glimpse. Just a glimpse when Elijah was being pursued by Ahab's forces, and he went up on a mountain and he began to pray. And he said to his servant, "Those who are for us are greater than those who are against us." And he prayed, and God opened the servant's eyes. And in a moment, he saw chariots of fire all around the mountain ridge. And he understood that the armies of God were fighting for him. What a great thought. The victory belongs to Jesus. And this time, finally, it's not a spiritual victory. Well, you know, spiritually we'll be good. No, this time it's physical. He's coming. He's coming back. And the victory is ours because we are on his side. Thank you, Jesus. Now, there's a physical / spiritual battle, and it's already being waged. And we know about this, and we talk about this, because the battle is a battle for souls. And there are forces of the enemy that want you to go to hell with them. And there is an undefeated king who has paved the way so we can be with him forever, and we won't suffer the same fate that the devil and his forces will suffer. But it's very much a spiritual battle and a physical battle, and it's being fought every single day. Then at Armageddon, the physical and the spiritual coming together, and we see that victory of Jesus. So this morning, I want to talk about what does the second coming mean for us today? And because we know this, how should we live? What should our understanding be? And there are some things in here that are so good, because when we understand that Jesus wins, when we understand that we're on the winning team, it changes our perspective. So what do we do with this? First thing that we need to know simply is this: we win. That is my Cliff's Notes version of Revelation. We win. That's the message of Revelation. You may fight your entire life, and you may be subject to the forces of sin and death and just all of the havoc that is wreaked on the earth through that. But in the end, we win. I like to win. NFL draft was this weekend. Teams got to pick some new players to help them what? Win. To win the championship. To get to the next level. Hats off to Josiah King. His little peewee football team won the championship, so he's feeling pretty good. How great would it be to know that no matter what happened in the game, in the end you win? What if you're watching your favorite team on a Sunday and in the first quarter, they're down 10? But you know in the end, they win. You just keep watching. You can't wait to see it. Even if they're down big, even if they're down double digits and it's the fourth quarter, but you know they win. Do you turn it off? No, I want to see them win. This is the promise that we have as believers. In the end, we win. This is so great. This is the best news. No matter how hard we've had it, no matter what difficulties, and they do. It's hard. Life is hard. There's ups and downs. There's seasons that just rack us. And I think every single person in here has gone through something like that. But listen, in the end, we win. Jesus wins. Our team, our side. We're not losers. There's no losers in heaven. We win because we are with Jesus. Because he is undefeated. As followers of Jesus, now don't get cocky. Don't be strutting around here like Tom Brady with 7 rings, all right? But we should walk in that victory. We should walk with a confidence and assurance, knowing that no matter how bad the third quarter gets, we're gonna win in the end. We walk in the victory that he gives us. So we got to remember that we win. And many times, probably almost every time I've preached a funeral in the last 2 decades, I remind people that there's more to this life. And there's more to this life than just this world. That there's something waiting for us. And we talk about eternity. We talk about the eternal reward. In Revelation chapter 21, as John sees this vision, he writes for us just a glimpse. The Bible doesn't tell us a ton about heaven. There's a lot of questions we have. What are we going to do there? What's going on? What's this? It gives us some information. But I think if he gave us all the information, it would just be too easy of a choice. He doesn't want to dangle that carrot so much. He just wants us to love him. But John gives us just a glimpse of what this looks like. Revelation chapter 21, talking about our eternal home and what it's all about. Verse 3 says this, "And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men.'" I'll explain that in a moment. "And he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them, and he will be their God." Revelation 21:3 is the purpose for all of it. The whole book. The whole reason for being, the whole reason for Jesus coming, the whole reason that we're in this equation is because at the end, God wants to be with you and me forever. This is his goal. This is his end game. That when it all settles, you get to be called children of God, and you get to be with him forever and ever. This is what it all points to. The tabernacle of God is with men. God living, dwelling with us. God wants to be your God. He wants you to be his people. This is what it all worked towards. This was the purpose. Sin got in the way for a while. Sin separated man from God, but Jesus made a way. There's some rough times, there's some ups and downs, but in the end, this is what God wanted all along, that we would be with him forever, that we would love him, and that he would love us forever. The tabernacle of God with men. John continues in Revelation 21:4, and he says, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there shall be no more death. Anybody got an amen for that? There shall be no more sorrow nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things are passed away. Everything that sin has brought on us in this life is gone. No more sickness, no more death, no more suffering, no more disease. Come on, church. This is what we're looking forward to. No more illness, no more emergencies, no more COVID. It's gone. No more death. We get to be with Jesus forever in a perfect world where we don't suffer or die or bear any of the effects of the sin that's all around us and just wreaking havoc on the earth. That's a good deal. This is what we're promised. This is what we're promised. We win. We get the championship. We get the victory. We get the eternal rewards. There's more to this life than just what's here. In fact, I've used the analogy before. This life is preseason. It doesn't even get going until we're there with him. This is just training camp. This is just learning to love him and live for him. But eternity, how short is our life when compared to eternity? How short is the 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, whatever we get? How short is that when we compare it to forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever? This is the promise for those who belong to Jesus. In the end, we win. In the end, it's all made right. In the end, we're reunited with our loved ones who know Jesus, who have gone before. Like, it's a party going on, folks. There's going to be a celebration. You get to go because of Jesus, because of him, we win. Remember that that's the message. We win. Second thing I would say, because we win, hang in there for the here and now. We can't be floating around our time on earth just thinking about heaven, be no earthly good. No, we have lives to live and things to do and difficult seasons and things that we have to endure, and God has a plan for us and things that he desires for us to accomplish. And it's going to be hard sometimes. But don't ever lose sight of the fact, in the end, we win. This is a reminder for you and I to persevere. Sin is defeated. Death is defeated. Satan is defeated. The second coming reminds us that we win. So when you want to quit, don't. Even when it's hard, even when you've gone through a bad season, even when you did something dumb, made a mistake, you failed God, you had a bad Monday, maybe you had a bad April, I don't know. Whatever it is, don't quit. Don't throw in the towel when victory is waiting for you. There's difficult seasons in life. We all go through them, but we don't quit. We're not quitting on Jesus because we win. When we know in the end that we win, there's no quit in us. We hang in there. Bible talks a lot about perseverance. Talks about how important it is that we just keep our eyes on Jesus, even when it's hard. Even when it's difficult. Why? Because eternity is on the line. Eternity is on the line, and the only way you can lose is if you quit. Just keep going. Keep trusting him. Keep trusting him when it's difficult. Keep trusting him when you're in a season and you don't understand it. Just keep trusting God. Keep your eyes on him, because remember, sooner or later, we win. We win because Jesus is the winner, and we're on his side. This is why we hang on no matter how difficult it gets. The enemy tries to discourage us in the present because he knows in the end we win. And discouragement's a great tool of the enemy. If he can get you to quit, maybe you lose with him. But no, because there's nothing that can happen in the present that can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. Don't quit. Keep your eyes on Jesus, even when the enemy wants to discourage you. And we've heard those voices from the enemy. We've heard those voices of doubt and those voices of fear and those voices of anxiety. We've heard those voices telling, oh, just give up, just quit. God doesn't even like you. Well, look at how terrible things are going for you. If God loved you, none of this would happen. That is the voice of the enemy trying to discourage you to get you to forfeit your victory. No way, not a chance. Don't get discouraged. Remember that we're victors in Jesus. The enemy tries to discourage us. He also tries to distract us. He loves to distract us. We're like that little ADD squirrel, man. Just, oh, what was that? Oh, ooh, oh, shiny object. Oh, we're distracted. The enemy would love to distract us. The enemy would love to get us to forget that we win, to forget that we're supposed to be eternally focused. The enemy would love to get you to forget that you're a child of God and you've been called by him and he has a plan for your life. He wants you just to get mixed up in shiny stuff, distracted. Don't get discouraged. Don't get distracted. Remember, we win this. We win this thing. So we have to keep our focus. We have to keep our eyes on Jesus. I want to go to the next couple verses in Revelation 21. And it lays out one more just amazing truth for us. Revelation 21, 5 and 6. Then he who sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. This is what God does for us. Making it new. Bible talks about we're new creations. Revelation 21 talks about a new heaven and a new earth. God ain't just slapping some duct tape on you and saying, all right, you're fixed, go ahead. No, we read about being new in him. Behold, I make all things new. God wants to do a new work in your life. God wants to do something powerful in your life. And he says, write, for these words are true and faithful. God, who has promised us the victory, who is making all things new. You ever have such a mess in your life that you don't know how you're going to get out of it? Have you ever you outdone yourself and you mess things up so bad you can't even envision a fix? You don't have to. He's making it new. God's making it new. He ain't fixing the broken thing. He's making a new thing. And I like what he says here. He says, right, because these words are faithful and true. See, when God delivers a promise, when he promises to make all things new, when he promises to give us the victory, when he promises to never leave us or forsake us, he never breaks his promises. He is faithful and true. If he said it, you can trust it entirely. Bible tells us God's not a man that he should lie. When God says it, you bet the house on it. Faithful and true. And verse 6, so good. And he said to me, it is done. Yes. Come on. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. This is how the Bible wraps up. It tells us how in the end we have the victory because of Jesus. And on that day, when all of this has taken place and you and I are before the throne, we will hear the great I am say those three words, so powerful. It is done. Your struggle is done. Your hardships, done. The frustrations that you feel, the effects of sin, done. No more. We look forward to that glorious day when Jesus pronounces, it's done. It is over. It is finished. No more struggle. No more striving. No more stress. It is complete. This is the final victory that we have as followers of Jesus in church. It just doesn't get any better than that. Because Jesus wins, we win. Because Jesus has been winning all along. He won at the cross, even though it looked like a loss. He won because he paid the price for our sin. He paid with his blood. He won at the empty tomb, absolutely. Then he ascended to heaven and he said, I'm coming back for you. I'm going to take you to be with me. And then he's going to come again and just put the final nail in the coffin. Jesus is returning and he is declaring victory. We talked about on Palm Sunday how Jesus rode in on a donkey. And when a king would ride in on a donkey, it represented he was coming in peace. In Revelation 21, the king is riding in again, this time on a white horse. And that means the king is coming to make war. Jesus is coming back to make war on the enemies of Christ, on the enemies of the cross, on the forces of sin and death and the devil. And we get to witness this whole thing. Because of Jesus, we're on the winning team. It's called the Battle of Armageddon. I read it. Doesn't seem like much of a fight. It seems very one-sided. Jesus comes and just takes it. And then scripture said, all the way back when the angel was telling Mary that her child would sit on the throne of his father David, when Jesus returns, spare you the details, 1,000 years he's reigning on earth, he will sit on the throne that David sat on. He will sit on that in that position of power, and Jesus, King Jesus, will rule and reign. So the last thing for you this morning is this. So what are you going to do about the kingdom of Jesus? Because on that day, we are told that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. But we don't have to wait till that day to confess it. Well, we don't have to wait until someday in the future. We certainly don't want to be on the side that against our will are forced to kneel and bow before him. No, no. What are we going to do with that kingdom? We're going to accept it right now. And we're going to bow our knee right now. And we're going to confess the name that is above every other name right now. We're not waiting for it. Right here, right now, so that we can be on his side, on his team, and that he would be our God, that we would be his people, that we will dwell with him forever, and it's done. Oh, come on. Monday morning rolls around. I'm like, I'm done. I can't wait for that day. I can't wait for that day when we're with our king and we can just done. done. And we have the victory because of him. Amen? I'm going to ask the team if they would come up as we close this morning. What an incredible promise we have as believers. Some of y'all need to smile more because we win, okay? You need to remind yourself that. Maybe we need to pull ourselves out of discouragement a little bit because we win. We definitely need to remember in difficult seasons that we will all have, that any setbacks we experience are really, they're temporary. Because in the end, we win. As we're partaking of communion this morning, I'm just thinking about this. I'm thinking about that victory that Jesus won for us. That you and I, we don't have to be separated from him forever. We don't have to be hopelessly lost in our sins. We don't have to just keep going through that same spiral of sin and shame over and over and over. Because of Jesus, he's given us this victory, and he's given us a message, and he's given us hope. And hopefully it's given us a sense of urgency to go to a world that really needs to know that their king is coming back, and he's coming soon. We win. We win because of him. This morning, I want to encourage you. If you're not sure where you are, get on the right team. Make sure you are with Jesus. Make sure you are not opposing him, but you are with him and you are living for him. Jesus is coming for us. We don't need to be afraid. We don't need to be anxious. We know what the end is. We know that Jesus wins. We know we can be on his side, on his team, the champion. So what do? Walk in victory. Walk in victory, church. Represent him well. And know in your heart of hearts, he's faithful and true. And the entirety of the book all points to one message at the end. We win because of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for the victory. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? We're going to close with a song and a brief time of prayer. And if you're here this morning, I guess the best way to put this after what I just said is you need to get on Team Jesus. You're here today and you're not walking with him. You're kind of doing your own thing. If that's you this morning, I want you to know his arms are wide open. The door is not closed. The opportunity is still available for you to walk with Jesus, to be with Jesus, to receive what he's done for us, to bring us this victory over sin and over death. And if you're here today and you're not walking with God, I implore you, get on his side. Get on his team. Jesus wants a relationship with you. He loves you so much. He did all this simply for the fact so he could be our God and we can be his people. His arms are wide open. He loves you still. Maybe you're here today and you're in your race and you're running and you just need strength for this battle. You're going through some things. There's some things in your house. They could be physical, financial, emotional, things going on in your marriage, things going on in your mind. Whatever it is, you just need some strength to get through what you're getting through. The good news for us is Jesus doesn't say, hey, you're going to win in the end. Till then, you're on your own. Not at all. He says, I'm going to walk with you every step of the way. So Jesus doesn't just promise us the victory later. He wants to walk with you now. Here today, if you're going through something this morning and you just need prayer, you need strength, maybe you needed the word this morning to redirect your attention on the victory we have in him, whatever it might be for you, I encourage you this morning, come and get some prayer so you can keep running, because we don't want to quit. We don't want to forfeit what God has for us. You're here today and you just have some other needs and you just need God to move. I'm going to ask our altar workers if they would come this morning. And as we close with this final song, We're serving a God who's the winner. We're serving the God who's faithful and true, the God who loves to give good gifts to his children. We got a lot going for us, church. So we have the opportunity to call on the name of the Lord. Whatever you need this morning, I encourage you, respond to him. Respond to him. Let's stand together. I'll close in a word of prayer, and then the team's going to come, and let's just spend these few moments seeking the Lord. Heavenly Father, we love you. God, we love you, and we embrace this promise that you've made to us. We embrace the truth of your word that simply tells us, because of Jesus, we win. Because of you, God, we have the victory. Lord, I pray for the saints this morning that they would walk in the victory that you've promised and that you've provided at the cross. Lord, that we would not be victims of sin, that we would not be defeated by the attacks of the enemy. But Lord, we would walk confidently because we know beyond a shadow of a doubt, when it all shakes out, Jesus, we're with you and we're on the winning side. Father, help us to just embrace this victory that you alone provide for us. And Lord, for any who are here today going through difficult seasons, going through hard times, God, I pray that you would be their strength and this reminder of victory would keep us running hard after you. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the promises of your word. Thank you that you are faithful and true. We can trust you in all things. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. If you need prayer this morning, get out of your seat. Make your way down front here. Let's seek the Lord together.
Give you glory. Give you glory. Glory. Glory and a thousand hallelujah. Oh Lord my God, how great you are. Honor, power, another hallelujah. Oh Lord my God, how great you are. Glory, glory, the thousand. piano and violin minister to you for a minute? It's still early. Let's just bask in his presence right now. Sing "What a Mighty God" one more time. Oh, what a mighty God, what a mighty God you are. What a mighty God, what a mighty God you are. What a mighty God, what a mighty God you are. Father, we thank you for the victory that we have in you, Christ Jesus, our King, our God, our Lord. I pray that this week we would bow our knee before you, Lord. I pray that you would reveal yourself to us, Lord, as we drive, as we work, as we spend time in your presence, Lord, studying the word on our knees in prayer. Reveal yourself to us. I thank you that we have the victory in you, God. We pray health and wholeness over this congregation, over our families, over our businesses, over our schools, Lord. We pray health and wholeness. We pray victory in Jesus' name, God. For I thank you that you hold all things together. And by your will, all things were created. And so, Father, before the rocks cry out, I pray that we'd lift our voice to you in adoration and in praise and in thanksgiving for all that you've done. We glorify your name in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming out. Enjoy your week. We'll be right back.
is His.
Changing, I see the dawn breaking, it's happening, the awakening. So come, Holy Spirit, come and hover over us. Holy Spirit, come and open the heavens. Fling wide the gates, unleash your presence, pour out your grace. Show me your glory, the power of your love, 'cause even a glimpse is more than enough for my enemies. Oh, you're mighty to save, and you're making a way to do so much more than we've known before. So come, Holy Spirit, come and hover over us. Holy Spirit, strongholds bow. We're gonna see the things of heaven here and now. We're gonna see a new revival. We're gonna see your kingdom power. We're gonna see the things of heaven.
Thank you.
change.